actually retention.
Welcome to Arcom Tech at ArtCamp Pilsen. Unfortunately, Olga Kiseleva is unable to contact us by Hangout video conference now. She sent me the text and video and asked me to present it to you in her behalf. I will try my best I can in English and hope that I won't offend your ears with my very thick French accent. So, Olga Kiseleva was born in 1965 in St. Petersburg in Russia. She shares her time between her home city and Paris. Founder of the Laboratory Art and Science at Université Paris 1, Panthéon Sorbonne, she plays a central role in pioneering research and reflection on emerging forms of creativity. Olga Kiseleva's installation challenges our affinity with the world in an excessive, hyper-connected, hyper-consumer society. Thus, she affords visitors the opportunity to pause a while, look at an exhibit, and gain some perspective on their use of digital technology and their attitude in the way they consume. The digital world, sciences, nanotechnology, coded messages, all come to almost palpable life in Olga Kiseleva artworks. Strange objects and surprising devices give substance to the artist's installation, only unveiling their mysteries to the inquiring spectator, who then penetrates an invisible universe inhabited by numbers, figures, and lines of code, where time passes, purchased at lightning speed like a commodity on the stock market. Or the spectator uses a smartphone connected to the World Wide Web to unlock the secrets of QR codes, for better or for worse. Ultimately, it's their own rapport to all things digital in their daily excessive time-consuming use that is revealed to them in brief sentences or video. Olga Kiseleva's work has been shown in numerous collections and exhibited notably at the MoMA in New York, USA, National Center for Contemporary Arts, Moscow, Russia, ARC in Paris, France, Kiasma in Helsinki, Finland, Consortium Dijon, France, Museo Nacional Centro de Arte Reina Sofia, Madrid, Spain, and at the Venice, Istanbul, Dakar, Tirana, Rennes, Moscow, and Berlin Biennale. So please, Lucas, the first video called Sensitive World. But just a moment, I will first introduce it. Imagined by Olga Kiseleva, Sensitive World, done in 2014, is a series of explorations into the concept of risk in today's world. Through her artistic practices, Olga Kiseleva challenges the new languages of art. Her work is firmly rooted in the art-science relationship and establishes a connection between nature and an ultra-modern world. From a scientific background, she often collaborates with researchers and IT specialists to develop multifaceted projects calling on state-of-the-art technologies. Olga Kiseleva's Sensitive World, since her experimental work at the crossroads of art and science, is a perfect match for showcasing artistic hybridity. Please, Lucas.
Thank you.
Et donc, il y a quand même un rapport entre l'amour et l'histoire qui n'est pas que mièvre, enfin, je veux dire, qui tient à cette idée fondamentale que l'amour, c'est la guerre.
And when you are a little girl, you will not have to go back to school. And there is plenty of time to be in school or in the school. You have to focus on one thing, those are the nice ones.
Now, the second video is called Contretemps. Contretemps, done in 2014, is a utopian concept that perceives the artistic space as a solution to stop time and propel installations and thoughts towards infinity. So, please, number two. Thank you. Is called It's Time. By contrast, It's Time, done in 2010, presents a model for an individual approach to time, a new style of democracy where the community chooses the speed that time advances at. Please, Lucas, number three. Olga qui se leva here was blending time, technology, and humor. Now let's go about the next video called About Nano in Art. Olga Kiseleva presents her concept of nano art. Please, number four.
Technology, it is not a new material. It is a new way to work with material. Like with nanotechnology, we don't work with the surface of material, but with its structure. And we can modify the structure of material. And when we modify the structure of material, we can modify its comportment and also how it looks and how we feel it. So with nanotechnology, we can work with all traditional materials, but inside with its structure. I think every artist should be a researcher because the artist is here not to make the world beautiful, but to make it better. And for this, he's working as a researcher. And he proposed a solution. Researcher can be scientist, but he can be also philosopher or doctor or artist. It is the same way to think and to go deep in each problem. What is important with nanotechnology, it is very small, or it is invisible, or it is new. It is not so new because it exists since every time. But what is important, it is another level to dialogue with material. And what is important too, it is not with technology we use, but what kind of message the artist is given to the viewer, and if the message is right, and also if the form of the work, if it is made with nanotechnology or with sculpture or with painting, the form has to be in adequacy with the message. And it has to be strong. And if nanotechnology can help us with it, it is a good.
Okay, while seeing her, one can measure the difference between her lively presentation and my dry reading. So let's go on. Custom made is the title of her lecture. The installation custom made changed the colors of the room in accordance with the color of the visitor's iris. As if it were custom made, the exhibition space is lit with the color of the eyes of the visitor. The color of the iris of each visitor is captured by a device and is converted into light. The work creates a poetic world that is colored by each individual. But beyond the poetry, the artist reveals in an ironic and jarring fashion the construction and perception of a public, collective space. On entering, the individual perception of the world is flattered as the previous visitor's presence is swept away. The custom-made project is a reflection on the superpower of nanotechnology, which is capable of manufacturing the universe to order with an accuracy up to the very last nanoparticle. On the one hand, nanotechnology is an opportunity for us to consider what are our values and goals. And on the other hand, it is a fertile ground for experimenting with new ways of manufacturing collective norms. Reflexivity, reflexivity means two things. First, that our society is willing to publicly question its values and goals. And secondly, that individuals are well placed in their ability to effectively weight up the production of collective norms. For example, in the mechanism of participatory democracy, the question ultimately is this: have our society really done with techno-scientific alienation and the rackets under the guise of reflexivity of research, are we not actually seeing the eruption of a new figure of alienation in and through all the techno-sciences, nanotechnology in particular, i.e. of a new way for individuals to become stranger in their own reality. The installation custom-made modeled nano-optic procedures, which allow for the modeling in real time of a space's colors. This technology was based on two methods: data analysis of color metrics and the transformation of white light into the desired color. As such, each visitor entering the room gave it the color of his or her choice. However, he or she would then become hostage to the choice of the next visitor. Please, Lucas, video 5.
Thank you.
Thanks, Lucas. The next one, the sixth video, is called Power Struggle. Performance using interactive video games. Power Struggle, done in 2014, demonstrates the artificial nature of conflicts when economic interests and financial privilege dictate outcomes. Please, yes.
Il a été disposé sur cet ordinateur quatre antivirus informatiques. Ces quatre antivirus informatiques ont été disposés à l'intérieur de cet ordinateur. Que dire ce lycée ? Comment vont-ils réagir les uns vis-à-vis des autres par rapport au fait d'être ensemble à l'intérieur du même espace? C'est un peu comme un combat de boxe. Vous avez un antivirus, vous avez un deuxième antivirus. Le premier antivirus met un coup à cet antivirus, qui n'a pas apprécié le coup que lui a mis l'autre antivirus. Alors il lui remet un coup. Il y a des dégâts qui peuvent se produire dans ce genre de confrontation entre ces programmes. Un problème. À votre avis, qui va prendre possession de cet ordinateur ? Les rouges, les verts, les jaunes ou les bleus ? D'après ce que vous observez, qu'est-ce que vous pouvez penser sur le résultat de ce duel qu'il y a entre ces quatre antivirus informatiques ? Sur cette victoire sans valeur, les verts, les rouges et les jaunes ont tenté de résister, mais ils n'ont rien.
I do my best in spite of my stupid French accent. It's a battlefield dealing in apparently with letters and maybe numbers, as you see on this screen. Needless to say that in the academic milieu, all these letters have absolutely no meaning. So nobody knows about what he or she is speaking about. When we speak about literature, we are attending now a fight. Let's say that the red one is definitely the Marxist theory associated with the color red. And here in yellow, we can say that this is the color of deconstruction. In my speech, it is deconstruction. Who has won in the battle. Don't take that in a pessimistic way. It's only an appearance. So today we don't know what theory will prevail in the field of literature on American campuses. I'm done.
physicists. Right. So that's how we break things down. And we can actually kind of, you know, see this in some way.
Yfirfæra sína sérfræði þekkingu yfir á þessa liti og lýsa bara áttu sem að þau ákveða sjálf hver verður og kemur í ljós.
Yes, I'm going to talk about my well, my area of interest, my research is in international relations, and we have some classical theories which talk about how states fight for control over the international system. And the classical theory is realism, which claims that states don't care about how powerful they are. The only thing that matters is that they are more powerful than any other state. And of course, as I start to say this, they start to fade a little bit. Have you noticed, you can see the percentage of the space that, of that, that they embody. So now they're down to 37%. You can see how you're sort of fading away. So maybe being cooperative isn't so good after all. I think we can see where this is going to end already. China is crowding out, Europe is disappearing. There's hardly anything left of Brazil. And the US is resisting, fighting to the last drop.
I'm going to depict the power circle behind the international financial crisis. And the four forces that we have are red being greed, blue being knowledge, yellow being isolationism and nationalism, and green being real assets and real productivity. In Athena, I'm going to talk about taking a leap. And when I'm in Athena speaking, sem að leysa þetta og þetta er svona fyrir að tósta þannig að við þessu tölvöfnum þannig að við fögnum til þetta. Og þó svo að Reykjavík sé þessi sögulega miðja þó að þar sé höfustöða stjórnsýsluðunar, þar séu skólandir og stutt á miðjina, þá eru aðrir hluti sem að hefta, það er þannig að vassveitum, þannig að það er 1908, það vantar höfn og það er ýmis tækifæri sem að ýmis staðir og hafa til þess að skjóta þeim hér fyrir þess.
Og kemur kannski ekki á óvart að það er Reykjavík, sem að reynir helst að streitast á múti til hafa hann frá ákveðin gæði. Þeir hafa jarðvarma, þannig að það er hérna hitaveita sem þýðir það að það er svo aðeins hægt að spyrna á móti fallbötnin. En þrátt fyrir það, þá er það Ísafjörður sem að verður höfuborg Reykjavíkur þegar að líf ekki sjálfvarma.
Þá ætla ég að segja frá því að ég valda að fjalla svona átök og myndri fæðubúra. Ég vil ekki kalla þetta megrunabúra, ég vil heldur kalla þetta fæðubúra. En þetta er í raunverulega átök og myndri uppfræðslu og ofstækis, átök og myndri mismunandi hjarðmennsku og kostnað heilbrigðara skynsemi, átök myndri afmarkaðra hópa, myndri kynja, stéttar, félagslegra stöðu, kynslóða, manneskju og markaðar, átök sjálfsmyndir og þjóðarímyndir, en fyrst og fremst eru þetta átök yfir á og völd og þar með yfir eigin holdi og annar. Sérstaklega þetta að mæta ásakir með vigtina með sér. Þetta hef ég séð með eigin augum gerast þegar fólk tekur upp vigtir í fínum boðum og vigtar ofan í sig matinn og vigtar svo kaffibollan og setur sem sagt nákvæmlega þetta mikið magn af mjólk út í kaffi.
The seventh video sent by Olga is called Urban Datascape. It was sent in French, and the text also. But I thought it very interesting to present, and I tried myself to resume a little bit the presentation. Olga's Kiseleva's creations convey a sociological aspect as a researcher and artist. Her most recent work, Urban Datascape, points to the climate problematics through an interactive multimedia installation on the banks of the Seine River near the Concorde Bridge in Paris. On one of the walls, a big QR code is facing the river. Its huge wooden pixel draws various levels. Once flashed, one may enter via a smartphone to an internet site presenting a panoramic view of the center of Paris. Please, Lucas.
Datascape vient dans une série de pièces sur la réalité augmentée qui a commencé en 2007 avec les premiers travaux avec les codes de Gematrix commencés au musée de Guggenheim de Bilbao. J'ai été toujours intéressée, touchée par cette relation entre le réel et le virtuel et l'influence que l'on pouvait avoir sur l'autre. J'ai commencé par travailler avec les codes-barres 2D en les plaçant dans l'espace comme des objets physiques qui donnaient accès, connaissance des savoirs, des émotions, des objets, des projets qui se trouvaient dans l'espace virtuel. Ça commencer par des toutes petites actions avec des textes, des images. Ensuite, les actions se sont complexifiées, à la fois dans l'espace réel et dans l'espace virtuel. Les codes-barres dans l'espace réel sont devenus les plus en plus complexes, des vraies installations de land art, des pièces dans l'espace public urbain, interactives, changeantes, comprenant plusieurs messages et plusieurs significations. Et dans l'espace virtuel, ils ont commencé à mener à des données les plus complexes et les plus importantes. À ce jour, Datascape, c'est le travail le plus complexe, parce que ce n'est pas seulement une pièce qui montre le lien entre le réel et le virtuel, c'est une vraie expérience menée avec toute une équipe, dont Guillaume Jacquemin et Étienne Delprat, toute une expérience de traitement des données, de leur visualisation, avec des nouvelles formes de navigation, des nouvelles formes de représentation des données, des relations qui s'instaurent entre les données, non seulement de façon logique, mais aussi de façon visuelle, plastique, et émotionnelle et évolutive.
Regret that the circumstances didn't allow Olga to be on the other side of a video conference to share herself the screen sharing, but I think the videos did present her work quite well, and I'm very thankful for her participation in this series of lectures. So I'm sending her my thanks, even if she will be reading and seeing them later on. And thank you very much for attending this lecture.